We are anyway on the code, so let's actually run the codes for different elements. Let me increase the font size. And what this code does is essentially it has one class all sorts of things, right? So for the sorting, and there are certain max sizes, etc., which I am defining. Also, I am using Chrono library, which is going to be allowing us to measure the time taken by different parts of the code. So essentially, how much time is taken by each sorting method that we are going to do. And the reason why we have, I mean, typically what we put inside a class is things which resemble some real world, right? But sometimes even things which are just related could be pushed together. For example, all sorts of things is not really an existing entity. But all these different functions, if I put them inside the class, then they will have access to the same array, as well as you will be able to use the same template for, let's say, measuring the time taken by each sort, etc. And there is a uniformity in terms of what is the input, what is the output, correct? So that's why we have put it. So there is an enum which defines different types of sorting methods. And all these function names which are used for printing are added into a vector of strings, and essentially that vector is initialized. Okay, so there is this there are two vectors. One is, I will show here, I think, where is that? Yeah, so this funds is a vector of function pointers, and so I'm keeping track of these functions corresponding to the, and their names are essentially inside this fun names. Okay, I should have kept these two together, but anyway, so their initialization is essentially happening here, where I'm initializing the pointer to the function in funs of ii, and their names as given by these strings is given in this, right? So that I can just enumerate those functions. I don't need to pinpoint a particular function. I can just go over funds of ii, right? And then ii plus 1, ii plus 2, like that. Okay, and then I'm also keeping track of the array and its size, which is the actual input array, right? And then there are other auxiliary functions that I might require for different sorting functions, so I'm using that. And then there is a comparison function which also can be used, but in general you can compare arbitrary types, so you can give arbitrary types, but this compare is going to be required for our std sort. There is a is sorted extra function which is used just to check that we are sorting it in the appropriate manner. Okay, so there are some functions like so that distinct is a function which gets used to initialize the array with unique elements, right? So it just checks if originally the element is present inside the array. The initialization happens with a random value, right? And then printing, then is sorted is just checks if the consecutive elements are follows greater, are in ascending order. Then swapping is okay, and then there, this is the start of different functions. So bubble slow part, that was the first part which we had. The first one going up to n, and the second loop going up to n minus 1. But then we realize that since the last I elements are sorted, therefore n minus I and so on. So we have looked at these codes, and you can possibly go through them. But my goal here is to actually run some of them, right? So bubble fast, insertion, shell sort, selection sort, which we are going to study today, quick, merge, heap sort, as well as radix sort. So all of these, I'm just going to run all of them. That test function is essentially taking that enumeration, and depending upon that, it is calling a particular function, right? So how does it map the enumeration with the appropriate function? Because enums are essentially unsigned integers. So if I give the same order, the value of that enum, that is bubble fast, is going to give me the function corresponding to that in that funds array, right? What does this test do? Test essentially is going to initialize the array, and then it starts the clock, calls the appropriate function, because that fun is the enum type. So with that index, I just call that function, and then I stop the clock. I print the array, I check if the array is sorted, and I print finally how much time was taken by this name of the function, name of the sorting method. In this count method, the time is measured. Okay, so let's try to run this and we'll see if it compiles. Okay, it doesn't compile, so I'll have to give probably -std equal to C++11. So there is no heap because we are using heap sort, so that is in heap.cpp. Okay, so it compiles, and as a good programming practice, I should actually compile it with -o3, which is the different optimization level, so that some parts might be compared. Okay, so now the number of elements is 1 lakh, and some method initialize this, and some method is running. Most probably the method that is running is the first one, which is the bubble fast or bubble sort, and that is taking some time. There is 1 lakh elements, and we have already waited for a few seconds, and it's going to take some time. And by the time it runs and gives the output, okay, so it has finished. It took 24.5 seconds, right? And it checked that array is sorted just to ensure that it is correctly doing the sorting. Session sort took just 2.5 seconds. So you can see the difference between even bubble sort and insertion sort. And shell sort, which was a generalization of insertion sort, took 17 milliseconds. Right? It's not going into seconds at all. Right? So you can see that the gap, this high level perturbation allowance, and then going slowly to the lower part, the smaller perturbations, that itself is helping insertion sort considerably. Right? And you can run it multiple number of times on different inputs, and you will see that almost the similar behavior happens. Okay. The selection sort, which we are going to study now, is going to take a little longer, in fact more than insertion sort, and we'll see why that happens. Quick sort is really quick, and no wonder it is the preferred method in, I mean, the sorting inside C is essentially quick sort, and that is also preferred method in many of the implementations. Merge sort, which is still better, I mean less than 1 second. Recursive formulation, it takes 0.7 seconds. Sort, interestingly, is fast, and it takes comparable to shell sort, right? And so is the case with radix sort also. Contrast it with what happens with C's queue sort. C's queue sort takes 18 milliseconds, right? So our implementation of quick sort is actually much faster. And the implementation by shell sort, heap sort, radix sort, right? These are unoptimized versions. We haven't really taken efforts to really optimize. This is a base plain vanilla algorithm. But queue sort is likely to be optimized. Maybe it uses a better partitioning, looks at multiple elements, etc. The std sort is actually very interesting, that it actually takes a much better time. And quite comparable to our implementation of quicksort, and we might be able to improve our implementation of quicksort to match this time. So as you can see, that you can implement actually the sort which is there inside a library, which gets used by millions of people probably every day, and you can implement it yourself. Okay, so yeah, any questions on this part? I strongly recommend that you guys run this code on your laptops and see how it performs on your laptops. The numbers might vary a little bit, but the relative performance should remain the same. It will depend upon how much cache you have and so on. So all of these are going to be affecting the performance. Okay, so if there are no questions, then we'll move to selection sort. The selection sort is going to be a method which is similar to what we did in case of bubble sort as far as invariant is concerned, but we will do it explicitly. In case of bubble sort, what we said is that the I largest elements are going to be at their final places because of bubbling. So So what we can do is we can make it explicit. So what I'll do is that I'll say that, okay, I'm going to choose the maximum element or the minimum element and put it at its final place. And the remaining n minus 1 elements, I'll resort using the same mechanism. Right? So this can be done in both ways, where you are choosing either the minimum or the maximum and putting it at its place and repeat it for the remaining part. So let's see how that happens. Okay, so choose the minimum element in this case, since we are doing it in the so you can do it in either order, ascending, descending, but I'm choosing the minimum element and we put it at its final place. The invariant is that the first I elements are going to be sorted. Right? So let's see if this visualized. If we go to selection sort, you can see that I'm going to choose the minimum element out of n elements. So that is going to be 2. And then I'll swap it with this element because that is where 2 should be. And after that, 3 is going to appear here. Then for the remaining n minus 1 elements, all these elements, I'm going to choose the minimum, which is 3, and then swap it with 44 and so on. So let's see if that happens. So 3 is compared with 2, so the minimum becomes 2, and now minimum is 1, so now minimum is at its place. Now we compare, the minimum is 5, then 3 becomes the minimum and continues to remain the minimum, and then 3 is replaced with 44. Now we again try to find the minimum. 5 is the current minimum, then 4 becomes the next minimum, and so on, and 4 is replaced with 38. So as you can see, the left part is first I elements are sorted and in their final position, and then the rest of the elements are going to get sorted as we go along. Okay. So this is definitely going to require order n square time, because the minimum finding is order n, and then the rest of the processing is going to be still requiring n minus 1 comparisons plus n plus 2 comparisons, n minus 2 comparisons plus n plus 3 comparisons, and so on. So that becomes order n square. Okay, so let's stop this and come back to this thing. Right, so now I'll wait for a few seconds for you to write down the code corresponding to selection sort. And if there are any questions, feel free to ask. Sorry about the noise, it's raining heavily here. Okay, so I'm assuming that you are able to think about how the implementation of selection sort is going to be. But the main part is essentially going to be finding the minimum. So assuming that this particular loop is going to find the minimum. We go to ith element and swap it with the minimum element. So that is what we did in the visualization. So so that is how it needs to be written. And we just need to go to n minus 1 because the final element is anyway going to get sorted. Okay. Any questions on this one?
Sir, I have a doubt on, like, when you showed us the absolute time, I understand that if I do it again, I cannot compare my current time with the previous time because some cache effects will be there. Mm-hmm. But can we compare, like, if I do some 100 times sorting, the data in seconds which I get, can that be unbiased? I mean, can that be used in some sort of understanding?
That's a good question. So ideally, when we compare two different algorithms to perform the same task, we are expected to run it multiple number of times, right? At least 3 times, larger, as large is better, right? So you can run it 10 times, 100 times. like we say that larger the data, you can find more insights into the data, right? So in this case also, you can run it multiple number of times, and then you take the average time taken by your algorithm to essentially weed out the effects of this caching and other maybe some. In this case, I am running it on the same laptop, and my Chrome is running and Firefox is running as well as OpenOffice is running. All of these should be shut down first. Only your program should be ideally running, no graphics, etc. So once you have done that, but many of these effects will go away, if at least relatively speaking, if the algorithm is run multiple number of times, and then you take the average and compare the two, right? So but yeah, so at least yeah, along with this information that what is the time taken by the algorithms, another important point that you should give is what is the configuration of your machine, what is the speed in terms of gigahertz, right? So what is the amount of memory that it has, what are the different cache levels that it has. So all of this information also should be provided, so that somebody who wants to replicate your results can come up with at least a similar configuration and expect at least similar results, right? So that is the hope, right? So especially in research papers, when we write, we give the configuration of the machines, under what environment I am running, even the operating system and the version of the operating system also starts mattering many cases, and you should provide all of that too. At least, I mean, the whole point is that I am doing this so that somebody else uses the code, right? It's not that I only want to declare, I don't want to shout, I want also that somebody should listen to it. So somebody should be able to utilize that code, so that the environment, if it gets replicated, then the hope is that there will be similar results. So you are right that it should be averaged out, and that will be the better thing, in fact the ideal thing.
Okay, sir. Yeah, one more thing. Yeah. Are the ratios will be same? Like, for example, we got 24,000 and 2,000 for bubble and insertion. Next time when we do, the ratios could be also same.
It's not guaranteed. But if you, I mean, the reason why we cannot guarantee that is because it is input dependent. So for example, if it's a totally random array, the set of inputs, then maybe this ratio comes in, maybe 1:10 ratio comes in. But if it's fully sorted, suppose, or almost sorted, as the input comes in because of random numbers, then it's possible that maybe bubble sort might work better, or insertion sort might work not work as better, or the opposite, and therefore the ratio might change from 10 to 8, something like that can happen. So that is not guaranteed. But for the same input, if you take the same input, then the hope is that it will settle at almost the same average. So if it is 10.2, maybe it will become 10.1, 10.3, but it will stay around the same ratio. That is correct.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thanks, Murari, for those questions. Any other concerns, questions here? So I think Murari's questions also reveal how we should be doing this when you are doing your projects as well as post projects. So I think that is how it should be done. All right. So let's move to the next part, which next sorting algorithm, which we have already seen, and that is our heap sort. So what we did is that given n elements, we built a heap out of it, right, which was our array 2i, 2i plus 1, right, or ith element as the children. And then we performed n delete maxes. In this case, we will probably do n delete mins on a min heap. And then whenever you get the element, you store it inside an array. Those input require n storage. Building the heap requires order n time. Performing n delete mins requires n log n time, and storing each element requires order n time and n space. And the question that we had asked was, can we avoid the second array so that we avoid this 2n space? Yes, that can be done using a trick using hide back function, where if we are talking about maximum element, then that maximum element can be hidden towards the end, and the remaining part still constitutes a heap. So this poses a little bit of problem in the context of min heap, The reason being that in case of min heap, if you find the minimum element, that needs to be moved to the left. And if you move it to the left, then the remaining part should be the remaining n minus 1 should be the elements of the heap, but that removes your nice indexing structure of I is going to be 2i, i's children going to be 2i and 2i plus 1, right? So that might get violated. So one of the ways in which this can be fixed is that you can move actually the elements to the, even the minimum element to the right, so that at the end the array is reverse sorted, and then you reverse the array to get the sorted array. So that requires additional order n times, so, but that can be done. Okay, alternative, if you are interested in the alternatively you can build a max heap, do a delete max and move it to the end. That is okay. Okay, so this was essentially our code, and as we saw, heap sort also is a very useful function from the performance perspective. You should explore this if you have alternative, if you want to look for something based on heaps as the sorting. Any questions on this heap sort? Okay, so let's look at quicksort. And as we saw, quicksort was essentially the quickest. So quicksort was designed, and it looks a little different from the other algorithms that we have seen. What quicksort does is that you are given this array, it chooses one element, and that element is put at its final place. Final place meaning in the sorted array, whatever is its final place, that is put. That is one part. The second part is it makes sure that the, all the elements to the left of that element that you have put at the final place are smaller than this element, and all the elements to the right are going to be larger, similar to our BST mechanism. But the left array and the right array need not be sorted. So that is, those are the two parts. One is pick up one element, put it at its final place, and ensure that all the elements to the left are smaller, all the elements to the right are large, and then repeat this procedure in the two arrays that you have obtained, and that essentially is going to lead to a sorted sequence. So this is slightly different, and as you can see, this is very similar to divide and conquer mechanism. And quicksort is an example of a divide and conquer mechanism. So we choose an arbitrary element that is called as a pivot, and we put the pivot at its final place in the array, and do some adjustments as required such that all the elements smaller than the pivot are to the left and larger are to the right. This procedure is called as partitioning. So as you can notice, the position or the pivot that you choose is going to be very crucial in identifying if the two left and the right parts, partitions, are going to be balanced or not. If you choose a pivot which actually happens in the middle, finally, you don't know. When you choose an element, you don't know if it is going to appear at the middle or somewhere else. If it appears in the middle, then you have nicely balanced two parts of the array. And then your complexity is going to be, as you can imagine, it is going to be n log n, correct? But if it so happens that the pivot is on one side of the array, either to the right or to the left, so it is essentially going to be nearer the minimum or nearer the maximum, then the partitions that you are going to get are going to be skewed. There will be one small partition, there will be one large partition. And then when you are doing recursive quicksort in the remaining part, this smaller part will be done faster, but this larger part will take longer. And in the worst case, you might end up doing order n work for this particular array in the next iteration. And therefore, the procedure will give you order n square processing time for quicksort. So quicksort, depending upon how the pivoting happens, can range between n log n and n square in the execution time. Okay, so as I was mentioning, it uses a divide and conquer mechanism. Let's look at how that performs in the visualization. Okay, so let's go to quick sort. It again the same set of elements, and what we are going to do in this case is we are going to choose the first element as the pivot table. First element of the array which we are considering as the pivot element. So now 3, as you can see, is a bad choice because 3 is just going to replace this 42. And what is going to happen with respect to the remaining part? 2 is going to be on the left hand side of 3, and all these elements in unsorted order, including 44, are going to be on the right hand side. Okay, so that is what we would like to see whether happens in the first iteration. We choose 3, and you will see that it gets compared, and then 2 is swapped. Yeah, so this is the result of the one iteration of quicksort. After choosing 3 as the pivot, 3 is at its final place. All the elements to the left are smaller, all the elements to the right are larger, but they are unsorted. Now we choose the remaining, the left hand side array, which contains only one element, so it gets done as it is. The right hand side part also gets chosen, and we choose the first element of the right hand side, which is 38, as the pivot, and we put it at its final place. That putting it will require you to go through the elements and swap if required. So all the elements to the left are going to get swapped with the right elements, which are larger than 38. Okay, so let's look at that. So that compares. So 2 is sorted. Now you compare and keep swapping the elements which are larger and smaller than 38. Okay, and as you will see, 38 is now at its final position, and that all the elements to the left are going to be smaller, all the elements to the right are going to be larger, and so on. Okay. Any questions on this visualization of quicksort or working of quicksort? So this is the left part of 38 which is done, and now the right part of 38 is going to get done, and that is going to finish now. Okay. There are some additional swaps you might see, and that happens because when you choose the pivot element, the remaining part needs to be processed with respect to the pivot element, and the pivot element gets swapped only in the end of the iteration, and therefore you see that swap only happening in the end. So that swap is essentially mentioned here. But yeah, that is relatively minor, but let that not add to any confusion in your mind. Right? Any questions on quicksort? Okay, so we'll look at the code. So quicksort at the high level appears really, really simple, right? Although there is a lot of complication that is happening. And that complication is happening essentially inside partition, but at a high level it's actually very simple. So we, from 0 to n minus 1, if start is less than end, I find a pivot using the partition method between start and end, and I do a quick sort on starting to pivot minus 1, because pivot is now at its final place, that is ensured by partition itself, and another quick sort on pivot plus 1 to end. So this is very similar to our binary search mechanism, and pivot is essentially should be the midpoint, but it need not always be. Now how do you design the partitioning? In this case, we just said that choose the A of start as the first element as the pivot, but you can do better because you want to have balancing across the two. So there is a lot of research on how this partitioning should be done. Sometimes what they do is you choose the first element and the last element, and choose one time the smaller one and the next time the larger one, right? So that you get some sort of balancing. There are ways in which you can choose 3 elements, right? Let's say you look at the first three elements, and you choose the median of the two or the middle of the two, and that is hoped to give you somewhat middle element in the overall scheme of things, right? So Yeah, so there are different ways, and there are, as long as you are looking at a few constant number of elements, that should be all right, and that can give you a better partition. Okay. All right, any further questions on Quicksort? Okay, so then let's look at the next divide and conquer mechanism. Right, so Quicksort, we said that it should probably balance it out as much as possible, right? But then why should we depend on the pivot element? Why can't we divide it ourselves like we did in the context of binary search, right? That I'm going to always do partitioning in the middle, right? So that essentially leads to merge sort. Okay, so merge sort is also a divide and conquer mechanism. It divides the array into two halves and then sorts each of the two halves separately. In this case, there is no question of pivot, right? So you are just dividing it into arbitrarily two arrays, and then individually you sort the two arrays. Now, that doesn't mean that the array is completely sorted. In case of pivoting, since pivot was at its final place and all the elements to the left were smaller, it was fine that you sort this part separately, and you are done. But now these are arbitrary elements. And therefore, if you sort this and sort this, that doesn't mean that you will get the sorted array. You will have to merge the two arrays. So merging of two sorted sequences we have done when we were discussing arrays. So we can apply those mechanisms to ensure that we get the final sorted sequence, right? And this we can do repeatedly. Repeatedly meaning recursively, you can divide the smaller two arrays into, let's say, four arrays and divide it further, until you are at the stage where you have a single element which is anyway sorted. Then single element per single element you merge, which means you choose the smaller of the two and put it at its final place, larger of the two, put it at its next place, and so on. So the worst case complexity of merge sort happens to be n log n. And as you can see, you are dividing it into halves. That goes to two elements, then four, then not elements, arrays, four, eight, and so on. So you require log n steps. And the merging time essentially is going to require order n time. In the worst case, one merge, and therefore n log n is the time that you might require for merge sort. So as you can notice, merge sort is n log n, both in worst case as well as average case. Whereas quick sort is actually order n square in the worst case, n log n in the average case. But we still use quick sort because the way we put it is that the constants involved are very large. And that does mean that the effects that the absolute running time because of this recursion, even if you implement it in an iterative manner, it might turn out to be still larger than quicksort. And this merging is the one that essentially kills time, and therefore the absolute running time of merge sort turns out to be relatively large. But it's a beautiful algorithm. It's a very good example of recursion, so to say, and very clean algorithm for that matter. So can you write the high level code corresponding to merge sort now? Okay, so the merge sort code should be quite similar to quicksort, just that in quicksort we were using partitioning first and then two recursive calls of quicksort. Here we are going to do the merging in the end, right? And with two recursive calls to merge for the two parts, because the merging should happen only after the merge sort is done. So that merge is the name of the function. So don't confuse it with the merge. The merge actually is the array merge. So we find the midpoint and we sort start to mid and mid plus one to end using merge sort. And then in the end, we merge these two, right? So how the array merge happens is something which we have looked at, but you can also look at it here. It's a little complicated, but I think you will be able to get it. Essentially, you have two sorted sequences, and as we were discussing, you have to look at the two smallest elements, and whichever is the smaller one, you choose it in the output sequence and so on. So in this case, I'm using another array to copy the elements. But as we have discussed, you might be able to do away with the second array, right, which I have not included. All right, any questions, concerns on merge sort? Okay, Shania, is it possible to do merge sort in place without the array copying? Yes, it is possible. If you recall our discussion from array merge, you will be able to do sometimes the maximum element, and that can give you the later part of the array, right? And that can allow you to do the array, avoid the array copying, and that can actually reduce the cost of merge sort. But you'll have to still take care of the recursive calls, right? So the recursive calls are very easy for us to implement, but may not be good from performance perspective. If you convert it into an iterative calls, then you will start getting seeing good performance benefits out of merge sort. Does it make it as efficient as quicksort? I don't know. I haven't tested this, Shania. Yeah, I don't know. I think that needs to be checked. Yeah, might be worth checking out. So what was our time with respect to merge sort? Merge sort was 778. If we avoid array copying, I think a lot of time. I think it will become comparable to quick sort, at least comparable to shell sort and heap sort and Redis sort. Whether it will be very much comparable to quick sort, I don't know. But definitely, it will come below 100 milliseconds is what I can think about. Yeah, that is my guess, but I think the copying is a large overhead. So if we can avoid that, that will be awesome. No problem. Any other concerns? All right. So let's look at... So this was our merge sort code. So there is one small theorem that we would like to see when we are talking about all these comparison based sorting methods, right? And what that theorem says is that if you are using comparison based sorting, you cannot do better than n log n. So in other words, it is to say that n log n is the lower bound for comparison based sorting. Okay, so the proof is rather simple. Essentially, it depends upon that one bit is required for one comparison, right? So you will require log of n factorial bits for n factorial permutations, because you would want to distinguish across these n factorial permutations of these n elements, right? So log of n factorial is lower bounded. This is something which we will have to believe, that n by 2 raised to n by 2 is smaller or equal to n factorial, and therefore log of n factorial is lower bounded by n by 2 log n by 2, which essentially is omega of n log n, which is the lower bound on n log n. Right? So this means that you cannot do better than n log n with respect to sorting if you are using comparison based sort. So then people started looking at, okay, is there any other way I should not look at the comparison? I have to do something different. I cannot just take the numbers as black boxes. I'll have to go inside the numbers. And that gave rise to bitwise looking at the numbers, or digitwise looking at the numbers, and use some sort of hashing techniques or indexing techniques, bucketing techniques to develop sorts. Unfortunately, because of that, the complexities may not depend upon the number of numbers alone, but it will start depending upon the value that is stored inside the number. So all these comparison based sorts We never said that what are the numbers or how big are the numbers. But as you start looking at the number of digits, number of bits inside the number, then the size of the number becomes important. And therefore, non-comparison based sorts will depend upon the value that gets stored inside. So for example, if you take merge sort, I don't care how big are the numbers or how small are the numbers, the complexity will remain in log n. But now for the non-comparison based sorts, the complexity will be dependent on the size of each number. Okay. So I think I should also mention that heap sort, merge sort are theoretically asymptotically optimal, right? So quick sort is not asymptotically optimal. Asymptotically meaning with respect to the time complexity wise, as n increases to infinity. Theoretically, these are n log n because these are meeting the lower bound. You can't do better than that, n log n. And these are meeting the lower bounds in the worst case. Therefore, these are asymptotically optimal. Quicksort is not asymptotically optimal. Insertion sort, bubble sort are not asymptotically optimal. But the performance of quicksort turns out to be good in practice. Right? So this is where the disconnect between the theory and practice can sometimes happen. Many times, theory gives you a good handle over, okay, this algorithm seems better. If you implement it, that is likely to perform better compared to the other. But there are sometimes gaps between the two, because when we are talking about asymptotics, we are talking about the worst case. We are not always talking about the average case. Plus the constants get ignored, right? The additive as well as the multiplicative constants. So that's where the disconnect can come in. All right, so we will look at the non-comparison based sorts, but probably in the next class. But if there are any questions, I'll wait for any questions here. All right, so if there are no questions, then we'll meet on Friday for our last class. See you then.